Shri Prabhupada Saraswati Thakur ki jai. Shri Radharasura Nidhi ki jai. So this is, we're continuing with verse 44 about the Abhisar of Radharani, and the title we gave this verse was the Mad Frenzy of Radharani's Rendezvous. Abhisar means rendezvous. When the beloved goes out to meet the lover. It can be Krishna running to see Radharani. Generally, it's the Nayaka, it's the heroine running to see the hero. So yesterday we described part of the verse. I'll read the verse again. Very beautiful Sanskrit verse by Sripad. Generally, we use the word Sripad, which means Sripad Prabodhananda Saraswati. Sadganda Malya Navachandra Lavanga Sangha Tambula Samputamadishvari Mam Vahantim Shamam Tam Unmararasad Abhisam Saranti Shri Radhike Karunaya Nucharim Videhi. We discussed a little bit about the word Adishvari. And there's three basic points in the verse. One is that the describing Radharani, this transcendental pastimes of Radha and Krishna. And the scene is that Radharani is running out of her house in Barsana or Yavat to go meet Krishna in the kunjas or on the bank of the Yamuna for the rasa dance, or in the kunjas of Radhakund in the midday, basically about 11:30 in the morning. It's not clear because the same arrangement, running to see Krishna in the morning or evening, is also called Abhisar. We discussed about that yesterday, and how Sripad is addressing Radharani as his Adishvari. Everyone knows Ishvara. Ishvari means supreme controller. So as in the mode of Radharani's maidservant or handmaiden, Sripad is adopting Manjari Bhav as humble, dependent and submissive maidservant of Radharani, rather than her usual identity as Tungavidyasakhi. Prabhupada Saraswati is Tungavidyasakhi, one of Radharani's most intimate confidential Ashtasakhis. Tungavidya, Lalita Vishaka, Tungavidya, Sudevi, Rangadevi, Induleka, etc., Champakalat, etc. So now she's so much attractive and so much attracted in appreciating the sevas, the moods and the bhavas, the bhav means the feelings, the mood, the love of the manjaris, that she's entered into their mood. So she's praying like one, oh Radharani, you're my controller, you're my Adishvari. So we discussed that. Now we're discussing this. Yesterday we kind of from the angle of the manjari is a prayer, please bless me, be compassionate to me, make me your servant. Now we're going to describe this mood, because we said it's Radharani's mad frenzy. And we described a little bit about that yesterday, how Radharani's running down the footpath. Even it's described because the Brajmandal, the Leelas of Radha and Krishna, they occur through six different seasons, Sadritu. And it's a very unique feature of Brajmandal. Everywhere around the world, and actually outside of India, in Bengal and South India, North India, only this small area, this area of Braj, and you can say this northern UP and part of Rajasthan. I don't even know so much Rajasthan, but UP for sure, and Vrindavan. And within, let's say, you take Mathura as a center, within like 100 kilometers or so, 200, whatever, there's a fixed diameter. There are six different seasons. But even if you go beyond that, you won't find six seasons. When you go to Navadvip, or you go to Jagannath Puri, famous pilgrimage places, or anywhere in India, Haridwar, Rishikesh, there are not six seasons. What to speak of Europe, Russia, America, South America, all around the world, there's basically four. It's not that they're just trying to split one into two. So winter becomes, because there's early winter and deep winter, which is what they call it, and early summer and deep summer becomes six. But they're distinct seasons, and they have distinct vegetables and fruits and root crops, haldi, turmeric, adrak and ginger, and so many things that are grown here that you won't find in Puri, you won't find in Bengal. Bengal basically has, or like Bombay, places like that, they have 2-3 seasons. When you go to Bombay, you don't know if it's winter or summer or whatever. It's basically one season. Basically, there's like summer and rainy season in Bombay. And if you live there, you understand. If you live in Puri or Navadvip, you'll see what is there. There's a touch of winter, hardly. And then it's just rainy season, clearly, monsoon. And then summer. So there's three. So Radharani's running out at all times of the year. And there's different climatic conditions and environmental conditions. And it's all outdoors. It's all in the forest, in the bowers, in the woods. It's nature. Krishna is the original nature lover. And that's the nature of the original. He loves the natural things in life, like most people of fine sentiments and refined intelligence and consciousness. They like the natural beauty of life, not the passionate tamasic cities and all these plastic and metal and steel. They prefer to be in a natural environment. So Radharani, when she's so much accustomed on this Abhisar to see Krishna, and here it's describing it, the phrase is used, Unmad Rasad Abhisaranti. This word, it says, Unmad Rasad Abhisaranti. Samsar Abhisar, Abhisam, Abhisam Saranti, which means she's maddened with ras. Oh Radharani, when will I, because Tungavidya in his mood of a mandri, he said, he's praying for this moment to show us that we should pray for this moment, when this moment will come in our bhajan, or when this life will come, when this moment will appear, what future life. But you can say, when will this moment come in our bhajan, in our smaran and meditation on Radha and Krishna's pastimes, divine pastimes, in the mood of their manjari, maidservant, and Raghunuga sadhana, as a Raghunugiya. When will I see, as he's saying, when will I see Radharani maddened with ras as she rushes out to meet her Shamsundar? Because that visual, as we mentioned before, the objects and visual impressions and sights that we see create impressions and depressions in our chitta, in our memory, you may say, our deep primordial memory. It's called chitta in Sanskrit. There's the senses and mind, intelligence, and ego, and beyond ego is chitta, and then atma. So chitta is where all of our experiences, good and bad, all of our desires, it's all stored there. And then it arises as vasanas. But what we see is more impressionable and it creates a deeper impression in our chitta than what we hear or what we smell or what we taste. Like we may smell something, we go somewhere in a very unusual place. Like maybe you're in, say Puri or something, walking down some street on pilgrimage or yatra, and suddenly you smell pizza. There's like maybe a distinctive aroma of that, and you're thinking, Jagannath Puri, a Mahaprasad of Jagannath, and the distinctive smell of oregano and whatever those spices are. I can't remember. I haven't seen such a thing in 40 years. It's not my what I eat, but you know, the thyme and rosemary, oregano, or whatever those things are, and together, and you go, and it's, oh, and you just smell that, and immediately you go to, oh yes, pizza, and then the last time you ate, or the next time you're going, whatever. So that smell became an udipan, or a stimulant, an excitant, to excite what? To excite your storage of impressions. That's called chitta. So it excited your chitta, and then you can understand and register that impression by the interaction of intelligence and whatnot. And your ego is like, how do you identify with that impression? Yes, that's pizza. Wow, it smells good. I want to enjoy. So that's your identity, your mindset, your ego. Aham, I am. Ahamameti. This is ego. Hung is called hankar. Hankar. Ahankar. Then there's hankar. Ahankar means without true identity, ahankara. So you have false ego and then a wrong ego. Then you say, oh, that smells really good, like pizza, I'd like to enjoy. I can't control myself. And then that when you say, I want, you can, if you just smell and say, oh, pizza, you don't accept, you don't reject, you just identify it. You identify it because you combine the sense impression with your previous, the sense experience with your previous impression, your citta. It produces thought and conception, and you discriminate what it is, and you accept or reject your conception on the basis of your experience and conditioning and knowledge. And you see, yes, it's definitely 100% pizza. It could be many things, but then you're so expert at that. And then you said, and you walk on, okay, fine. No, I don't eat that anymore. But if you say, oh, it's really good, I really like that, I want to enjoy that. And when you say, I want, then that's an vasana, a desire to express your ego, that I want. If it's I, aham, and want, it's false. if we think he wants or she wants, he meaning Purusha, Purushottam, Lila Purushottam. This is Purushottam month, so we're worshipping Purushottam. Purushottam, the greatest Purusha. But there are different Purushottams. There's Vaikuntha Purushottam, there's Maryada Purushottam, and of course there's Madhurya Lila Purushottam. Even Ramachandra you can call Lila Purushottam, although he's not. He's called Maryada. He comes to establish. Maryada means protocol. Maryada means behavior, right dealings, law and order, etc. Maryada has many meanings, just like if we don't treat other members of institutions with proper regard and respect, or we're good and you're bad, then that's a breach of maryada. It's bad manners. It's bad thinking. Everyone, it's called sadhu ninda. The namaparad, first aparad is sadhu ninda. Ninda means against, to violate, to debilitate, or to ridicule. And sadhu, the actual offense in Padma Puran is very generic, but we generally have heard it described or translated as to offend the Vaishnava devotees of the Lord who have dedicated their lives to propagating the holy name of the Lord. So that, of course, is a purport, and that's true, that a Vaishnava sadhu, who is a pracharak, he may be like that. But what if you are a worshipper of Durga and you're a saintly lady, and so, oh, she's okay, we can offend her. She's not preaching and she's not a Vaishnava, because that's how we're defining. Sadhu ninda means to offend the Vaishnava devotees of the Lord who are spreading the glories of the Lord. I don't know if you're familiar, but it's told like that generally. But sadhu ninda means anyone, any lady or gentleman of any age or any country who is pursuing transcendence. They're actually trying to, from their own conception, and there are three bona fide and acceptable conceptions of approaching the Absolute Truth described by the greatest learned sages in the universe when they gathered at Naimisharanya. Vedanti tat tat vividas yad taj jnanam advayam brahmeti paramatmeti bhagavan iti shabyate. They said, people that are curious about God and interested to understand God, they have the idea that he's Brahman. He's all amorphous and he's everywhere, all pervasive, and he's omnipotent, and he is not even a he or a she, but rather it's that soham, that I am that entity, that consciousness is Brahman. It doesn't have a gender. It's existence, eternal existence, consciousness, everywhere. And I am a particle of that consciousness. And my problem is that I'm a particle of consciousness mixed in matter, covered by matter. So I suffer because of my mixture and identity with it, birth, death, old age, disease. Janma-mrityu-jara-vyadi-dukha-dosha-nadarshanam. If I get free from this, that's mukti, sayujya, mukti. Nirvikalp mukti. So I emerge in that consciousness, and like the river merges in the ocean, and experiences that vastness and oneness of the ocean. So that's one conception. So we should respect everyone. So now this, back to the verse, this Unmad Rasat Abhisaranti says here in the commentary, I'll just share with everyone, maddened with ras. Of course, the question is, what ras? Because it says Unmad Ras. So Unmad Ras, it's already told. Unmad, of course, she's mad, but there's also ras and Madhurya, or Stairati, the Stairati of Madhurya Bhav. There are different rasas produced, prema ras, bhakti ras, when you combine the feeling, different emotions combining together, and different septic bhavas and anubhavas and vibhavas and sanchari bhavas mixing into the ocean. There's like so many rivers come. One river may be muddy and one river may be clear. One river may be full of spring water and mineral water. One may be reddish mud or yellowish mud. Then they all mix into the ocean, all those colors and flavors and contents, and then enhances and gives variegatedness and variety to the ocean. So the ocean, the vast ocean, is one's permanent, unlimited, basic, foundational, loving relationship with the Lord in one of the four rasas of Braj. And thus, the ocean of Dasi Ras and the ocean of Vatsali Ras or Sakhi Ras or Madhura, conjugal love. So these all these rivers, all these different four bhavas, they mix together in the ocean of your sthayi bhava and create ras. Ras means liquid. The ocean is liquid, water. Ras means aesthetic rapture. Some Sanskrit, it's a tough, difficult word to translate, but some Sanskrit devotees and learned-wise devotees, they translate ras, rasa, as aesthetic rapture, divine rapture. Srila Prabhupada translated as mellow, devotional mellows, M-E-L-L-O-W-S, mellows. Rather interesting. So it's a very enigmatic word because we don't have any framework of experience of ras. We have some idea of this prakriti ras, material experiences of the mother and her child or whatever. So it's Unmad Ras because in Madhura Rati, when Radharani is totally, it goes into Sneha, Man, Rag, Anurag, Bhav, Mahabhav, and then Mahabhav becomes Modan and Madan. Then Madan becomes Unmad. Madan means Cupid or intoxication or madness, Mada. Then Unmad means Uttama. Totally mad, totally madness. And it's transcendental, divine. Divyonmad. Divya means divine, spiritual, transcendental, alokic. So Radharani becomes that, because that's her position of her heart, Mahabhav. She's full of this Mahabhav, Divyonmad. So now that Mahabhav, which is her basic sthayi rati, is Madhura Rati, full of Parakiya Bhav and Mahabhav. And then she experiences different rasas and flavors, and Unmad Ras. So this is the madness she feels to going to see her lover. So that she's running to the ocean of Madhurya Ras or Madhurya Rati, and she's running to her Parakiya lover. Parakiya. Parakiya means belonging to another. Kiya, belonging, para, another. In other words, extramarital love affair. Right? We have that. There's marital, married, and extra means my husband plus one more, or my wife plus one more. That's not no more over here. It's supposed to be like that, but it goes on. And everything has its origin there. So Krishna, this is the greatest taste in ras, and it's divine. Radharani, you can't hide your love, you can't hide your envy, you can't hide your anger, you can't hide your greed. Everything is registered on the screen of your face. Prabhupada said the face is the index of the mind. So it's clear to see the greedy man and greedy woman. Their eyes tell it all. Eyes and face and everything together. So now, this is a Tungavidyan Mantri Bhav running, seeing Radharani. Say, come, let's go. And they say, well, Radharani, you haven't finished dressing you. You only have one earring on. Just forget it. I'm going. Just go. And so you're seeing Radharani, that look, that excitement in her eyes, that glimmer, that mad look, but not mad like some crazy person or a puggle or pugolini, of this world, but the madness of divine rapture, the madness of pure love for Krishna, just sparkling out of her eyes and face, and it's an amazing sight to see. And Prabhupada Saraswati Sripad is seeing that in his meditation and writing about it. Hey, listen, everyone, look at this. I saw this amazing thing. Now we see, everyone surfs the internet. They find some amazing thing, like a little monkey driving a motorcycle. Somebody sent me something. There was some you know, the guy trained the monkey. So he's a little monkey and a little, like, scooty, I think, called scooty or some kind of small, like, little thing, but with a motor and everything. And he put a helmet on, like a racing helmet. And the monkey had racing pants on, like these guys in Grand Prix, you know. And it was just, first he has his helmet off. You could see he was a monkey. And the trainer was there, and all the kids were on both sides. And they put the monkey on, and he put his helmet on. And then he just put it in gear or something. And he said, the monkey just, hold on, he's trained. So the monkey's going, whoo, like this. He's going really fast. And then he falls off. But because monkeys are so expert, they're only going like 20 kilometers, 30 kilometers, but it looks pretty fast. He's like 20 feet, 30, maybe 150 feet. And then he fell off and just did a bunch of handsprings and stuff because he's a monkey. So they always land on their feet and everyone's laughing. So it was a funny thing to see, amazing thing. Because especially if you didn't live in Vrindavan, you wouldn't even think of looking at it. But since you live here, somebody sends it to you. So we share it. So look at this. You have to see this. And people write on their Facebook, a must. You just have to. You won't believe this clip. And whatever. And everyone knows. So here in the Shastras, the Acharyas, the Rasikjan, they're all coming from Golok to this plane of Boma Vrindavan. And they're with Radha and Krishna eternally. Nitya Siddha Parishas and Nitya Sakis and Parama Prashta Sakis. So they're saying, look, I want to share this with you. I can't take a picture, but I'm trying to give you a picture in Sanskrit poetry. Because this is a poem. Sadganda Malya Navachandra Lavanga Sangha Tambula Samputamadishvari Mam Bohantim Shamam Tan Unmana Rasad Abhis Sam Saranti Sri Radhi Ke Karanaya Anucharim Videhi. Oh, yes. So if we have any sentiments, or we have any experience or knowledge or rasa gyan or rasa gya or rasa gyan, then when we read that, then we'll say, oh, you shared a very nice thing for me. See, I saw it. It was fantastic. I saw what you suggested. I chanted japa. I chanted shudanam. And I entered into a deep state of meditation, and I had lila pravesh. I entered into the Leela in my Smaran and had a sporty. I saw Radharani's Unmad Rasa Abhisam Saranti. Thank you for sending me that. thank you for sending me that clip, that shloka. So he's inviting us to see this. Maddened with Ras, Radha runs out to meet Shyam. And Ujjala Nilamani by Sri Rupa Goswami Pad. There's one chapter, 19 or so, called Shringar Bed, where he's describing Shringar Ras, which means the erotic flavor of eroticism or erotic love that arises when the lover and beloved meet. Shringar Ras, a very special feature of Radha and Krishna's Parakya Bhav. So this is a whole chapter about that. So Rupa Goswami defines, what is this unmad? He says, what is this state of divine madness? Because there are many mad people in the world, everywhere. But we read that even God is mad. Krishna is mad and crazy to run after his devotees. Sometimes Krishna is running down the footpath. Where are my devotees? Where are my devotees? True devotees, pure devotees, surrendered devotees. So Mahaprabhu was running all over India. It is said he was moving around India on the pretext of looking for his brother Vishwarup, whom he found when he went to Pandharpur in Maharashtra. Then Mahaprabhu discovered that his elder brother of Vishwarupa, who had taken sannyas, he had entered the body of Lord Vitalnath. There's a famous deity there, Rukmini and Krishna, and I believe Krishna's name there is Vitalnath. And he became one over there with Vitalnath. But that was, of course, the external reason, but he was actually looking for devotees and making devotees as he ran down the footpath. So the sometimes Lord Chaitanya is described as being mad, the divine madman, the golden madman. And people would come when he was in Mayapur displaying some of that madness and the ecstasy of separation from Krishna in Radhabhav, even before he was married. And people would come to Sachimata with Ayurvedic oils. And they would say, I think your son is suffering from your Nimai, your Vishambhari, he's suffering from Vat Rog. His Vata is disturbed. If you rub this oil on his head, that will adjust his life airs. And his prana will come in balance and he won't act like a madman and speak like a madman, chasing his students in this. He's a Brahmin of a high-class family. Jagannath Sutta, Jagannath Mishra Sutta, the son of Jagannath Mishra, Shachi Sutta, Nittai Shachi Sutta. This is, I think, Sri Padaindra's deities, Nittai Shachi Sutta. So he picks up a stick one day and starts chasing his students and chanting, Gopi, Gopi, Gopi. So imagine you go to Sanskrit school and your teacher picks up a stick and starts chasing you, Gopi, Gopi, Gopi. And you say, I'm not a gopi, I'm a Brahmin boy. What are you talking about? So obviously you would think he was loco, cracked, you know, puggle. So they suggested that. So he's mad in the ecstasy of unmad, same madness, the same unmad, rasad, abhisamsaranti. Mahaprabhu's experiencing Krishna. Now Krishna is experiencing the madness of Radha. Radha is in madness running to see Krishna. And that divyonmad parakya ras, madhura ras, madly running down the footpath of Vrindavan. So Mahaprabhu is madly running down the footpaths of Jagannath Puri. Where's my Shamsundar? Where's my Brajendra Nandan? Ah! Running out of his house in Gambira, running down the footpath to the Mandir, Sri Mandir, in Radhabhav in the middle of the night, 2 o'clock at night. Jaga Gaga, Jaga Gaga. So then Krishna got to experience Radharani's Unmad, Rasad, Abhisamsaranti. Mahaprabhu was also an Abhisarika Bhav, adopting the Abhisarika Bhav of the Nayaka Radharani, that mood of a Abhisar means rendezvous. So this is, Rupa Goswami defines this unmad as a bewilderment of the mind which makes one continually think of the beloved everywhere at every moment. So this is different than material madness. Material madness is I am the prime minister. Yes, listen everyone. You say anything, and you say any crazy thing, you think any crazy thing. I am God, or whatever. A mad person. Of course, many people think that. But this is very specific. It's a transcendental. It's a transcendental phenomenon only in Radharani and partially in the gopis, her gopis, and reflected fully in the hearts of her maidservants. They experience all her Mahabhav and their maidservants like Sri Rupa Manjari and Tulsi Manjari. So this state of, this is amazing. Everyone should be mad like this. Like Prabhupada said, we have to become madmen. I don't know if Prabhupada said, but we have to become madmen, mad for Krishna, mad for Radha, mad for Gauranga, mad for Guru Seva. We're not so mad about that. But just see what a beautiful type of madness. Imagine if the whole world was mad like this. If everyone's mind in the world was continually thinking of Krishna everywhere at every moment, then everyone would be considered mad by Rupa Goswami's definition. So they'd be madly in love with God. The whole world would be full of premi bhaktas. Nice. Really nice. Because premi bhaktas love everyone, and they love all the animals, and they love all the birds and squirrels and seals, squirrels and seals and whales and quails and every other kind of animal flying and swimming and crawling and running, jumping. This is a premi bhakta. You love God, you love everyone and everything. Premi bhakta loves the earth. He loves the water. He loves the sky. He loves the mountains. He won't harm them. He won't harm the earth or the mountains. They're all his relatives and brothers. Everything and everyone is a child of the divine. And live in harmony. If there's love, there can be harmony. Without love, there is war. This state of love madness especially occurs. So let's hear the definition again. What is this divine spiritual madness? Well, if I had the power, if you could do something, what would you do? I would bless everyone in the world that they would get this disease of divine spiritual madness. Oh, that's very nice. Swamiji's blessing the whole world to become divinely spiritual mad. Because then if you have food or you don't have food, or if you're wealthy or you're poor, it doesn't matter because you're mad. You're in love of God. You don't know whether you ate or you didn't eat. You don't know if you're hungry or not hungry. Because you're transcendental to your body, you're absorbed in divine madness and seeing your beloved everywhere. The state of divine madness, divya, divyon mad, is a bewilderment of the mind. So I want to do jadu. Jadu means hypnotism, magic. I want to do jadu. There's a bewilderment of the mind which makes one continually, that means moment to moment, think of the beloved everywhere at every moment. So anywhere I go, on the train, on the plane, on the boat, I'm thinking of Krishna, 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 Radha, 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 Seva, Seva, Seva. Even devotees are supposed to be mad like that. You have Kantimala and Tilak and Guru and Nam and Mantra and an Ishtadev and a do puja and you follow Panchanga Bhakti and you live in the Dham, but are we mad? Because only the divine madmen have darshan of Radha and Krishna. Narada Muni was mad. He's 5 years old. His mother dies with a snake bite. And he's thinking, oh, now what to do? My mother died of a snake bite. If I go to my uncle or my grandfather in the village and say, Mom died, then they'll say, oh, okay, we'll take care of you. We'll send you to Gurukul. We'll arrange a nice marriage for you. We'll get you a good job in our cloth business. He was thinking, this is not a good idea. And what to do? But I have. But my mother's there, and I'm the only son. It's responsibility to take care of the mother's, the antyasti ceremony, the cremation. Anyway, this is quite convenient. We live in this grass house, and she died there in the house, snake bite. I just set the house on fire, and she gets instant cremation. So I've done my duty as a proper husband. Proper dharmic son. A putra, and then I take sannyas. Then he's wandering everywhere. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. He's just wandering everywhere. I don't know if he was naked or not. I didn't read very clearly. With clothes or not clothes, I can't say. He's wandering through the villages and the mountains and everywhere. Everyone says, who is this mad boy, crazy boy? He says, Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya, Om Namo, everywhere going. And what happened? He had darshan of Ishtadev. So madness is the requirement. The mad saints of Bengal, the bowels and the owls, but they're sometimes considered sahajiyas because they maybe don't follow very properly. But in one sense, although it doesn't mean we go around breaking windows and creating, tamasic disturbance. But we have to be mad in our consciousness. If that's madness, then we should all desire that madness. For every moment we're thinking of Krishna. Lord Chaitanya is telling you the same thing. Everyone, he's ordering everyone in Shikshastam. Krishna Chaitanya is telling you the same thing. The Rupa Goswami's definition. He's telling everyone, hey, everyone, at every moment, think of your beloved. Wherever you go, Wherever you go, at every moment, think of your beloved Krishna. So Krishna, he's telling everyone to develop divyonmad. How so? Kirtaniya Sadahari. He's saying Kirtaniya Sadahari, Mahaprabhu. That means sada means every moment, eternally, forever, wherever you go. Every moment, every time you spend a moment, you're going to be someplace. So automatically, when you say sad, it includes time and place, because time and place are inseparable. You can't have time without a place. You can't have place without a time, because time is Krishna controlling everything. Everything is moving in time, happening in time. So, Kirtaniya Sadhari, everywhere, at every moment, chant Krishna's name. So if you imagine if you're doing that, what will people say? What's with this guy? He sits in a prasadam hall, everyone's trying to take prasadam, and he's going, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna, Hare Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna, Hare Hare. And I sleep in the ashram with him at night. He's Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, 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 Hare Hare, Ram Ram. He's in the bathroom. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna. What's with this guy? He's cracked. No, he's Krishna conscious. He's following Lord Chaitanya, Kirtaniya Sadhari. Oh, how fortunate. I remember one devotee in L.A. when I joined in 75. We were all there in the dormitory. It's kind of like a dormitory, ashram, I guess you call it. Ashram, we're all sleeping on the floor, about 60 devotees, you know, men, brahmacharis. So there was one devotee, when he was sleeping, it seemed he was totally sleeping, and he wasn't aware of it in the morning. But we said, you know, all night long you're chanting. Do you know that? He said, oh, I don't know. And when he woke, he wasn't anything particularly special about him. He went in the kitchen and cut vegetables and did what everybody does, you know, basic services, preach or sell books, whatever. I don't remember. But at night, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare. And he didn't have beads. He was asleep. I mean, he's like. So we thought, that's nice. And so in those days, we didn't have these boxes that you plug in and Prabhupada chants Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna. You have these boxes, what do you call it, japa box or something? And you plug in electricity and Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna, Krishna. What we call it, japa box, you know, little sound thing. Well, they didn't have all that in 1975. But we, and at least in our temple, we had a japa box. This devotee was a japa box. He was a living electric box. He would just chant all night. So that's the idea of the madness at every moment. So this state of love madness especially occurs when Radha first falls in love with Shyam. Well, of course, that happens with everybody. When you first fall in love, you're a little mad. And in one of our several classes ago, we described the five primary effects of Cupid, Kandarpa. When we get hit by his arrows, then the first one is Sammohan. Sammohan, everyone knows Mohan or Mohini Murti. It means become deluded, become bewildered by and fascinated by the form of another person. In other words, attracted. Really attracted. And then Sammohan, and then Stamba. Stamba means pillar, stunned. It means that Stamba means bewildered. What does it mean? It means you forget everything else. It means stunned. You forget everything else. So when you fall in love, you forget everything else. And you become so attached to the other person, bewildered by their form, fascinated by, attracted by. And then you act stunned. You kind of forget everything else. You forget about what you're supposed to do or where you're supposed to go or who you are. Or you forget your husband and wife, whatever. Or dharma or whatever. So then that's the second one. And the third one is unmadani. Unmadani means unmad, the same word, unmadani means intoxicated. And you act foolishly, you start acting very foolishly as if you're intoxicated. So that especially is prominent when one first, quote unquote, falls in love. So it's told by the Acharyas that when Radharani first fell in love with Shyam in the Bhoma Vrindavan Leela, this stage is called Purva Rag. Purva means prior. Just like the eastern direction is called Purva Dig, because that's where the sun first comes. That's the prior, the primary first Purva dig. Then Uttar dig is one of, is in the northern side, Uttar. Somebody's trying to sneak in the door. Radhe, Radhe. Come in, close the door.
I'm ready to see you.
Radha Rani ki jai, jai jai Shri Radhe. Okay. The feeling is mutual. Dhanavats. Rani. Rani. Sit by the, over here.
Can you translate, Marci? Can you translate?
What language?
Hindi.
I'll try sometimes.
Maharaj, मैं आपको मैं पहले भी आया था मैं आपको दर्शन नहीं कर पाया अच्छा मैं really by heart आपको दर्शन करना चाहता था thank you so much
कहाँ से आया
इंदौर
oh इंदौर बहुत दूर है अभी यात्रा है ब्रज यात्रा
नहीं महाराज मैं दिल्ली आया था किसी काम से
so this state of divine madness and love madness especially occurs when Radharani first falls in love with Krishna this stage is called Purva Rag which means prior attachment and attraction before first union. And it's a very especially sweet and wonderful time for both lovers. Even there's a phrase, where does it say? Well, anyway, everyone knows that the very beginnings of anything are exciting. The beginnings of anything are exciting. School, when you first started, when you kind of liked it and got over your initial fear of even going to school, you maybe started to like it. And then after a while, you said, oh, it's too much school. I don't like it anymore. Or anything you do. Or you become first joined Krishna consciousness called Utsahamayi. It's in the Madhurya Kadambini, Anartha Nivritti section. It says Utsahamayi. That went, the one's very enthusiastic when he first joins. Oh, I learned Mardanga, I learned the shloka, I learned the samsara prayers, and I know how to offer my food now, and I know how to offer an artik, and wow, I'm so excited. So then, you know, the first couple of years, it's really lots of utsah, excitement, enthusiasm. And then it goes kind of down for different reasons. So everywhere, so even the transcendental relationship of Radha and Krishna when they first fall in love, it's a very special, sweet time. So this is being described here. And day and night, at this time, in dreams or wakefulness, the form of Shyam appears in Radharani's heart, and the form of Radha appears in Shyam's heart, a beautiful form. So this is such a nice time. So Vidagdha Madhav is a book by Rupa Goswami Pad, and he's describing, he wonderfully depicts Radharani's Purva Rag. So this commentary is explaining that this verse can be indicating why Radharani is so much Unmad Rasad Abhisam Saranti. That this is Abhisar. Well, she'll go out every night, and every morning, every night, Radharani will run away from Yavat. Or Barsana to meet Krishna in Radhakunda or Vrindavan or some other place in Braj for their leelas, intimate leelas. So it's a regular thing. But why? So he's implying, the commentaries are implying that this phrase, Unmad, she's an Unmad Abhisarika, rather than an Abhisarika. It's not just a regular rendezvous, it's those very, very early beginning rendezvous. That's like when two lovers are meeting, maybe they're not even married and they're secretly meeting. So it's very exciting. Oh, we have to be careful. Oh, see that car? I think that's my father. You know, get down. And get down. So then father drives by and just sees some guy in a car. But if he sees his daughter there, then it might be trouble. So it's very exciting and so much fear and will we meet? He's late. I'm here, looking this way. Where is he? But then finally, lo and behold, you may after some time get married, and it's like, hello, yeah, pick up some sabji on the way home, and goodbye. This, hello, this, that. And everything is so, there's no more excitement anymore. It's pretty usual thing. But Krishna consciousness is actually very exciting all the time. I've experienced that quite a bit myself, how exciting it can be in Krishna consciousness. It's a real roller coaster ride. At least for some people, it's kind of same old their whole life. But I can't say the same about myself. It's been quite an amazing ride. When I joined in L.A., I couldn't imagine it if I wanted to write the wildest science fiction script about someone's life, I could ever come up with what my own life. So everyone has their exciting lives. So Vidagdha Madhav, it describes a very nice leela of Radharani's Purva Rag, that one day Vishakha Devi noticed that her dearest girlfriend Radhika was acting in a very absent-minded way. It means she wasn't thinking very clearly. Vishakha understood very clearly that Radharani's heart was thoroughly attracted to Krishna. So she thought, oh, my friend is feeling so disturbed and so agitated by her budding love and deep attraction for Shyamasundara. I have to comfort her. I have to relieve her anxiousness. So then Vishakha sat down, because they're expert in all the kalas, all the 64 arts. So Vishakha sat down and painted a beautiful painting of Shyamasundara. And then she thought, well, because Radharani is so much hankering to see Krishna and hankering to meet him, and how will it happen? She's a princess in Barsana. He's a prince of Nandagaon, and she can never leave the palace, and he's always with the cows or with his mother and father. Where will we meet? You know. So then Vishakha thought, well, if I give her a painting, like, you may not have a person, but if you have his picture, then you'll feel some connection. We don't have Krishna. We can't hold Krishna's hands and walk with Krishna or massage Krishna's feet. But Krishna said, no, I'll give you my form. I'll give you my murti. And I feel, oh yeah, okay, Krishna, you're here with me as a murti form. So now I feel a little relieved. I can serve you like this. So she thought, Vishakha rightly thought, that this would work to pacify and relieve the anxiousness and disturbance of Radharani's heart and mind. So she gave the painting. But what happened? It backfired. Rather than pacifying and mollifying and making her peaceful, then Radharani became even more, had the opposite effect. It created total havoc. Havoc means she went mad. She said, oh, it's nice. Oh, it's a nice painting. Oh, Sham, I feel so, I just want to sit and look at him. I feel so relieved. Thank you, Sham. Oh, that's him. And she went even more crazy. So after seeing that painting of Sham, Radha went mad with love. This is what's being told in Vidagdha Madhav by Rupa Goswami. Radha became Prem Pagalini. Pagalini is feminine, crazy. A lady totally mad in love. The Lita Vishakha saw the transformation Radha, this Pagalini, Radha, and they asked her, what happened? Kya hua? What happened to you? Are you okay, Radhika? And then Radharani, in a choked voice, she said, oh Sakhi, a young boy whose body is as beautiful as an bodily effulgence is as beautiful as an emerald, and who wears a peacock feather on his head, he came out of this painting. Then that handsome youth, he glanced at me and slightly smiled at me, and then I became mad. So by this leela in Vidagdha Madhav, well, let's finish it, then we can discuss. So then Radharani says, oh, Sakhi, whether I saw him in a dream or whether while awake in the day or night, I don't know anything anymore. All I know is that I am completely inundated by the streams of bluish nectar dripping from this effulgent moon that has agitated my heart. So our heart is like an ocean, and when the full moon rises over the ocean, it surges with waves and currents and eddies. The tides crash, the waves crash more forcefully on the beach, and the level of the ocean, tides rise more and more and go up further on the beach and wash away the boats of the fishermen, because they didn't anticipate that increase of volume of water due to that response and agitation in the presence of the Chandrama. Radharani's heart is that ocean of Shamras. So just by this seeing this painting, she had the experience that Krishna came out and winked at me and smiled at me, and I went mad. As a man will go mad, a man who sees a woman he's attracted to, and she smiles with acceptance and with interest and with excitement in her eyes, then he'll go crazy. So it works the other way around too. In this case, Radharani is, she says, I don't know anything anymore. All I know is I'm completely inundated by the streams of bluish nectar dripping from this effulgent moon that has agitated in the ocean of my heart. This is Vidagdha Madhav, Act 2, verse 1 through 9. A very nice point. This, of course, is the Adiatmika Vichara, Adidaivika Vichara, the transcendental level. But from our consideration, we can draw some teaching here in terms of sadhana tattva, that we're describing this section of Vidagdha Madhav. Of course, it's ras, and it's the madhura ras and sakhi lila and of Radharani and her sakhis in relation to Shamsundar madhura lila being depicted and showing this madness in Purvarag, this unmad, what the verse is displaying here. Shamam, shamam tam, shamam tam unmada rasad abhisam saranti. This abhisar, this rendezvous, bhav and mood of abhisarika bhav, of the nayaka. So we can, that's one level. But another level, what we hear here is there's a painting. Vishakha has painted Krishna, Bhagavan. So painting means chitra. So in Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu, it describes that there's different forms of murtis. Archa murti, archan, archan worship, murti, deity. They can be manufactured, or let's say carved or produced from wood, like Jagannath, or neem wood, Gornitai, Daru Brahman. They can be carved and sculpted from granite, marble, and metal. They can be molded and produced that way. Gopal, Radha and Krishna, Ashtadhatu are simply brass or bell metal murtis, or they can be made from jewels. If you're really rich, you can have a solid blue emerald deity of Krishna. blue sapphire, dark blue sapphire from Africa, whatever. So not only that, but murtis can be painted. It's called chitra murti. Then there's the manasik murti, the murti in your mind, the temple of your mind and heart, where in your mind you establish the deity of Radha and Krishna, Gauranga, or your guru, and you meditate on them, you dress them, you bathe them, you massage them, you feed them, you serve them, you move with them, you sit with them. That's called the manasik murti. And you do manasa seva. This is part of the practice of Raganuga Bhakti, the mental murti. So then the Chitra Murti, they oftentimes the Lord is installed. We have Pran Pratishtha. Putting Pran, put Pratishtha, establishing life or transcendence in the Prakriti. So metal, Krishna, this metal form of the deity, Ashtadhatu or wood, then they have a ceremony and mantras, and then the Acharya or the pure devotee, he invites the Lord, and there's various rituals and rites. But the main situation is by his pure devotion, he brings the Lord into this world, Krishna Sankarshani. Prema attracts Krishna, and he asks the Lord to enter the Murti and receive worship of the devotees there. It's called Pran Pratishtha. And that same ceremony, Pran Pratishtha, is done with chitra, with paintings also, where you have a painting, then you do rituals, and you install, you invite Radha and Krishna and Lalita Vishaka, six Goswamis, or Panchatattva, to enter the painting and receive worship of your disciple or the devotees. So that's called Chitra Murti. So the Chitra Murti is also Satchidananda Vigraha, is also transcendental. It can speak to you, can hear your prayers and reciprocate with you. So this, you can say, well, what's the Praman? You could cite this chapter 2 or Act 2 from Vidagdha Madhav and so many other places. Krishna is not limited. He's fully present in the Manas Murti. In your mind, you're meditating on Radha and Krishna's Bhojan Leela, and they're taking bhog in Radhakund. And some sakis have offered them some nice kheer, sweet rice. And Radharani is very pleased with your service, so she says, hey, Manjari, take this sweet rice, take this kheer. I think you like it. You can take this prasadi kheer. So that Manjari eats that prasadi kheer, all in meditation, while serving the Manasik Murti. And suddenly that Manjari gets indigestion in her Siddhadeya. She eats too much sweet rice, too much Mahaprasad. Sounds familiar, no? So then that meditation stops, and that Manjari comes back to Sadaka Avesh, or this form as a Sadaka, and then does not feel very well, and oh, my stomach hurts, and some doctors are called in and say, oh, this Goswami, this person, he's this Vairagi Sadhu, Niskinchan Vairagi Sadhu, who simply takes a little Madhukari, he's suffering from indigestion. And how is that possible? Well, it's possible because his name is Das Goswami, Raghunath Das Goswami. And while serving his Manasik Murti, so that's why I'm saying the Manasik Murti is fully Satchidanand. And he ate that sweet rice given to him by the Murti in his mind, Radharani in his mind, and the Leela, Madhyan Leela, Radhakund. And in his Siddhadeya's Tulsi Manjari, he ate too much of that sweet rice and got transcendentally upset stomach. And then having that effect in his sadhaka roop, which you might say is his material form, although even his that form is divine, it shows that the Manasik Murti is fully alive, fully transcendental, fully reciprocal with the devotee, of course, at the high level of prema. So the same applies to the Chitra Murtis. When you're worshiping the Lord, maybe the Lord will speak to you and say, oh, how you offered me this boga, but it's not very nice. And why you put the tulsi leaf upside down? You're supposed to put the tulsi leaf shiny side up. But you put the other side up. This is wrong. Why you put these dried tulsi manjaris on the boga? It's scratching my throat. You're too lazy to pick some fresh leaves. So maybe the deity will speak to you. So this is, here Radharani is handed a painting of Krishna by Vishakha. And everyone says, what's wrong? She's gone mad. And she says, yes, this boy who wears a peacock feather, he came out of this painting. This boy that you painted here in this painting with a peacock feather and a vamshi in his hand, vamshidhara, he's come out of the painting. And he's danced with me around the room and he embraced me and kissed me and then went back in the painting. what's this? What's happening? Oh, you're mad, you know. So then somebody, and then they go out, and then you sit there and you say, they think I'm mad. They don't believe me. And then the person's looking through the window, like hiding. And Krishna says, they're all stupid, you know. You love me and I love you. And say, well, can we dance again? Okay. Then Krishna comes out of the painting and dances some more. Then the person's outside and he looks, my God, Krishna came out of the painting. So anything is possible. Gatana agatana patiyasi shakti. Krishna's power is unlimited. Yoga maya is unlimited. Make the possible impossible and the impossible possible. Radharani is not mad. It happened. That handsome youth, that Krishna, that Sham Sundar means handsome, beautiful. Sham Sundar came out and he smiled at me and I went mad. Then the Sakhi said, oh, what is this? It's only a painting. It's only a chitra. You must have been dreaming. I don't know. I wasn't dreaming. So Radharani tells us, it doesn't matter, I'm dreaming, I'm awake everywhere I see this person. So now this same Prem Pagalini Nayaka Radha is running out to meet Sham. Rasavichar, there are 8 types of Nayakas or heroines which display 8 different psychological conditions. There's Nayika, Bhav. So there's different positions of their mind. Their heart, the heart of every lover or beloved is in love with the lover. But then the heart is fixed. I love my beloved. The lover loves the beloved, and the beloved loves the lover. But then the mind can change different circumstances. So the psychological position, the feelings, is like the mother always loves her son, but then he does something, then her mind changes again, and then she gets angry and gives him a slap. Doesn't mean she doesn't love him. You nonsense. You know, you started to push the baby off the roof. You know, you jerk, you cracked. He gives a slap to wake him out of his nuttiness or whatever. So I wrote down some of them here to give an idea of these different psychological conditions. One is called Abhisarika Nayaka. The mood, the thought, or the psychology, thinking of the Nayaka, the heroine. It's a girl who, this is defined as a girl who travels through the night to meet her lover at an appointed place, and she hurries to the place of rendezvous. Then the second type is called Vasan means dress, Vasaka Saja. This type of heroine, she's gone to the kunja. She's waiting in the kunja in the forest bower for Krishna to come. And she decorates the kunja very nicely. And she proudly dresses herself in her best possible clothes. And she's very eager. She's very eager to meet the beloved. And she's very eager to receive her lover in the kunja. And she often gazes down the path and waiting for his arrival. In other words, she's there and she's decorated the kunj very nicely and attractively, and then she's decorated herself and ornamented herself very beautifully and all cosmetics and mascara and everything. And then she's looking, well, come, where are you? I'm ready, I'm waiting, I'm anticipating. That's called Vasika Saja. Then the third type of heroine is called Utkantita. And this heroine, she waits in a state of eager anxiety to meet the beloved. That's very similar, but it's more intensified. First, she decorates the kunja, goes in and out. Oh, where is he? And then, he's not coming. It seems to be. It's getting close to the appointed time. Then she becomes very utkantita, very eager, very much hankering. So that's a more accelerated state of the mind. So the psychology, the position of the mind changes. So then the other aspect, I said that this is a prayer for seva, but Prabhupada Saraswati, in Mantri Bhav, this word is there, anuchari. And I defined that the other day. Chari means to move, chara chara, in Hindi, chara chara. Anu means after. So anuchari is another way of saying kinkari. The word kinkari, ai nanda tanucha kinkaram, kinkaram, this is in Shikshastakam by Lord Chaitanya. Hey Nanda Nandan, I am your kinkar, that's the male form, means servant, because he's a male person is saying it. But the female form, gender, is kinkari. It's a combination of two words, kim and kara, kimkari. It means, how, kim, how can I serve you? It's like this. Kinkari means, oh master, oh mistress, oh Ishwari, oh Prabhu, I'm standing with folded hands in submission, in humility, in eagerness, full of enthusiasm and submission. How may I serve you? How may I serve you? O Swamini, O Ishwari, that's Kinkari. So that's the maidservant, the Manjari, the Dasi. Then another word that's used in this verse is Anuchari. Shri Radhike Karana Karanayanucharim Videhi. Oh, Shri Radhika Karuna Mayi Radha, you're very merciful. I want to be your Anucharani. I want to be your Anuchari. I mentioned that the other day, what it means. And Anuchari means chara, I want to follow, I want to run Anu after you. Especially when you're running down the footpath for your avisara, which I explained the other day. So the Anuchari is chasing the avisarika. Anuchari Manjari is chasing the avisarika saki, Radha. Prayer for seva, and then vahantam. It says vahantam means the verb is there, and the second line tambula samputam adishri vahantam. Vahantim means to carry. There's the same verb in the Bhagavad Gita, where Krishna says yoga kshema. Says I forget the whole verse just now. It's yoga kshema mahamiham. I forget. I preserve what you have and I carry what you lack. Ananyas chintyanto mam ye jana prayapashate tesham nityabhivudam. Yeah, this verse in Bhagavad Gita says, Ananyas chintyanto mam ye jana prayapashate tesham nityabhivudam yoga kshema mahamiham. Krishna is telling in Gita that those that are fixed in loving devotion, submission to me, then I yoga shemam vaham yaham. He says, I carry what they lack and I preserve what they have. So sometimes commentators on Gita, they said, oh, this can't be that Krishna carries. I think Krishna made a mistake in this verb in the Gita. It's not, it shouldn't be vaham, it should be karam, karaham. Karam means do. In other words, Krishna doesn't personally carry things and give things to his devotee, but he karam. He works or he arranges through demigods and through his energies and other people to give things to the devotees. So then some acharya named Arjuna, by the way, he commented on Gita and he crossed it out. Oh, it doesn't mean this. So then Krishna came to his door, disguised as a young boy, carrying all kinds of groceries on his back, and his back was scratched. And there's a long story in the Tika of the Bhagavad Gita, quoted by Vishwanath. So this is the same verse that the Manjari, in Manjari Bhav, Sripada is praying, Vahantim, I want to carry with my own hands a tray, and on that tray I want to carry a garland, and I want tambul and kapoor. So that's what he says, Saganda. What he discusses, Sadganda means good quality perfumes, like jasmine and others, rose, whatever. And Navachandra means camphor. And then betel leaves, all carried in a gem-studded box, samputam. So there's a small meditation given here in the purport. It's evening, which I said, it's 10:30 in the night, and Radharani is extremely eager to meet her beloved Shyam at the appointed place. The verse says that Radharani is madly going out, and the Manjari is, as Radharani is running down the footpath. Actually, I didn't make the point. I forgot the point. When I said that Radharani was running madly, and there's six seasons, and Radharani goes out in all seasons, I actually forgot the point I wanted to make. And the point was that Radharani runs out in the winter time down the footpaths, and she runs out in the spring, but she also runs out in the rainy season. And these footpaths are not made of cement or asphalt or macadam. They're just brajaduli, a mixture of the cow dung and the natural earth and clay. So when it rains, they get very, very slippery. But before the rainy season comes, Radharani Sakhis and Manjaris, they have a special playground in Barsana where they train. Like they have training tracks before you go to the Olympics. You have some track where you're training on and running around, and finally you go to the Olympics. So the Sakhis and Manjaris, they have some training grounds for Radharani. So they set up a whole footpath in the back of Barsana in her playground, Radharani's private playground. And it can be summertime, and they sprinkle all kinds of water there. They wet it all down, so it's all muddy. And they say, okay, Radharani, now practice running without slipping. Because if you slip, you know, it's a full moon night. Remember, it's a full moon night, and it may be raining. It may be have rain just before, you know, that night. So you have a white dress on, you know, fully white dress, and if you get mud on your white dress, it doesn't look so good. And it can't dry clean it when we get to the kunjas. So it's a little difficult. There's no electricity out there, and we don't have dry cleaners anyway. So then you have to run in such a way to that muddy footpath that not a drop of mud gets on your sari. What to speak of slip on your face. So then Radharani goes up and down, and she holds the hands of some sakis, like when little kids get a bicycle. First they get a little bicycle, little extra wheels on it, and they learn how to balance like this and that. And then finally take the wheels up and fall off 100 times and finally and get a big bicycle. Everyone knows. So Radharani is, you know, one sakhi on either side, one manjari Tulsi manjari holding one hand. Okay, now walk. So she walks. And then, now go faster. And she walks faster and then run. So Radharani goes in training for the Avisar. At least we heard Manacharya tell like this. Like someone said, where's that in Shastra? I didn't see that, you know. But there's Leela Vichar, and there's the stories of the Brijavasis. There's many sources of these things. But we have to consider, is it Apasiddhanta, and is it Siddhanta Virud, and is it Rasa Apasiddhanta? Is it Rasa Abhas, and is it Siddhanta Virud? Is it against the Shastra, against the philosophical conclusions of Tattva, and is it against wrong rasas? So it's not. It fits. Radharani does go in Abhisar, and she does go out throughout the year, and these are all facts. So at this point, okay, it may be an embellishment, maybe true, but we heard. So now imagine running madly. It says, Unmad Rasad Abhisar. Radharani's running madly down the path. So she's madly going out. So that's why I said all these 6 seasons. So in some places, you know, there's not so much rain, but in the old days, there was so much rain here. So the Manjari is running behind, carrying garlands and a box of betel nuts and perfumes, and she's following Anuchari. At that time, the Manjari pleads with Radharani, "Oh Ishwari, have pity on me. Please slow down. I can't carry all these items for your seva and run so fast down the path." That's a very sweet comment in the Tika, in the commentary of Radharani. It's just why I told another class how we went on morning walk with Prabhupada, and he was walking his normal speed, and we're all running behind him. Prabhupada, slow down, we can't keep up with you. He was 80 and we were 24. He was just effortlessly, and we were so the Manjari is pleading, "Oh Radharani, I'm, this perfume may drop and may spill and have these garlands, and I don't, if I slip." And so this is a beautiful verse describing Radharani's madness and the Sakhi's seva, the Manjari's seva at that time, and then their prayer. Nice perfumes, flower garlands, and betel nuts mixed with camphor, fresh camphor, and cloves. O Ishwari Radha, O my princess, I will carry all these beautiful items for your seva in a jeweled locket box, samputam. Maddened with ras, you rush for rendezvous with Sham, Shamam tam, Unmad, Rasad abhisam saranti. O Sri Radhika, I beg you, I pray to you, please, O Karunamayi Radha, O Karunamayi Sri Radhika, please be merciful, by your merciful favor, please accept me as your Anuchari, as your loyal, as your own. Anuchari Dehi, Anuchari Dehi. Please give me, please give me, please give me service as your Anuchari, as your personal, loyal maidservant. And there's another translation here. I'll read the verse also last time. Sadganda Malya Navachandra Lavanga Sangha Tambula Samputamadishwari Mam Bahantim Shamam Tam Unmada Rasad Avisam Saranti Shri Radhike Karanaya Anucharim Videhi. When can I... Oh, excuse me, wait a second. Oh, this one, the other translation I want to read got slipped off here. Oh, yeah. Oh, my goddess, oh, Adishri, is translated as, oh, my goddess, Radhika, will you kindly accept me as your maidservant? As you madly go out to meet Shyam, will you please allow me to carry nice, fragrant perfumes and scents and beautiful garlands of flowers and a box of fresh betel nuts mixed with fresh kaffir and cloves for your pleasure and for the happiness and satisfaction of your Shamsundar? So this is the 41st verse of Radharani's Abhisar, running out to see Krishna. And tomorrow will be verse 48. And that the theme of that verse is, if anyone has the book is in Russian, Hindi, Bengali, English. This Radhara Sudaniti you can get. Radhara Sudaniti. It's available here in the opposite Radha Gopinath Temple. There's a bookstore. Radha Gopinath Temple on Prikamar. You go across the street and say, where's the bookstore? Where's it? And they'll tell you upstairs and they'll show you. It's Radhara Sudaniti, and it's published by, and all, most of all these commentaries are by Anantadas Pandit, which we're sharing, Srila Anantadas Pandit. And it's a mixture of his commentaries with commentaries written in the 1920s by Madhusudan Das Adhikari, a great devotee, and 1950s by Srila Anandagopal Goswami Prabhupada. He also was called, many people are called Prabhupada, Rupa Goswami Prabhupada also. Srila Anandagopal Goswami, he gave commentaries in 1950s, and then those commentaries, and then together, and then Srila Anantadas. So very beautiful commentaries, and so we're sharing those and adding some things here and there. Books are available. You can get and read the commentaries and get more deeper understanding and reminder, and then see the differences also, because everyone sees in a little different angle. So it's not simply a not just reading it. I've taken notes on it. So any questions on the verse itself? If anyone has other questions, they can come on Sunday between 4 and 6. I have a little satsang or whatever you want to call it. Questions and answers. All right. No. Radhi, Radhi. Radhara Sunidhi ki jai, jai jai Shri Radhe. Radharani, Radha Govinda Dev ki jai, Shamakunda ki jai, Radha Kunda ki jai, Purushottam Adhikatmas Bratta ki jai, Prabhunananda Saraswati ki jai, jai jai Shri Radhe. Shama.